It's the Christmas season, and because of that, possibly we need a little bit of renewal, dealing with our Christmas shopping and the different things that are expected of us and we expect of ourselves in the Christmas season. So I'm going to ask that we take a few moments to go into a healing treatment. And if you would, put both feet flat on the floor, your ankles crossed, whichever is the most comfortable for you. And just think along with me, let your eyes close. Let's think along together for just a few moments. I turn away from the outer world for a few moments to enter into that beautiful inner world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. To turn my mind from the outer to the inner. And yet, to keep my focus on the entirety of my body. For my body is an expression of the perfect spirit that dwells within it. The presence that is God living within me. And so I open my consciousness, every cell of my body, to the consciousness of God living within me. I open all levels of my mind to the indwelling healing light of God's presence, that whatever negativity may reside within any level of my mind is sublimated into the light of God's presence here within me. And so moment by moment, breath by breath, the light of God's perfection that is within me travels into the nucleus of every one of the millions of cells of my body, healing, renewing, regenerating, and restoring each and every cell. That all of the rhythms and motions and energies of my body now are in a state of perfect divine equilibrium, perfect harmony with the perfection that is God's presence here within me. And yet, to keep my focus on the entirety of my body, for my body is an expression of the perfect spirit that dwells within it, the presence that is God living within me. And so I open my consciousness, every cell of my body, to the consciousness of God living within me. I open all levels of my mind to the indwelling healing light of God's presence, that whatever negativity may reside within any level of my mind is sublimated into the light of God's presence here within me. And so moment by moment, breath by breath, the light of God's perfection that is within me travels into the nucleus of every one of the millions of cells of my body, healing, renewing, regenerating, and restoring each and every cell. That all of the rhythms and motions and energies of my body now are in a state of perfect divine equilibrium, perfect harmony with the perfection that is God's presence here within me. God is. God's perfection is. And that perfection is reflected in every cell of my body. I am totally under the influence of the greatest power in the universe to heal, to maintain health. The power lives within me and I within it. One mind, one life, one heartbeat, one breath. I in the all and the all in me. Perfect. Whole. Complete. Our subject this morning deals with understanding the outer inner teachings of Christ, or the secret teachings of Christ, because the secret teachings of Christ have been around for over 2,000 years, and each century there are a few people that awaken to these teachings, while the majority of people that incarnate just sort of slumber through spiritually through life. And so I'm going to ask that you turn to your affirmation sheet that's in your program, and we'll take this one step at a time. I'd like to do this, which is the first of a four-week series, as an introduction to the secret teachings and why they exist as they exist, the difference between the outer and the inner, so that we have more of an appreciation as we go into this each week during the month of December to celebrate the birth of Christ, that we have this feeling here of understanding why all of this is as it is. Because, of course, the first question that one might ask oneself is, if there is a higher spiritual truth, why isn't that truth spoken of? Well, 2,000 years ago was the same situation. Why wasn't that truth spoken of? Because people can only comprehend that which they're ready to understand. Let's suppose you have a small child as an example, and you're trying to teach them about life. You know that you can only tell them so much when they're 1 year old, 2 years old, 3 years old, 4 years old, 5 years old, and lo and behold, what a difficult time when they become teenagers. That it's like already they know everything that is to be known, but you know deep down inside of yourself how much they have yet to really find out. It isn't that you say to yourself the teenager is wrong. You recognize the teenager is not awakened to what life is all about. You realize that the whole of this world is set up in various stages of awakening. And when it comes to spirituality, that's basically what it is awakening or reawakening as we go through life. People are awakened at a certain level of spirituality, and they find a particular religious faith that corresponds to whatever that awakening is. It isn't that we spiritually grow. Oftentimes when I hear the term spiritual growth, I cringe, because there isn't anything to grow. We don't grow at all. We already are all that we could supposedly ever grow into. Jesus tried to emphasize this to his disciples when he said, "Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit to their stature?" In other words, we are what we are. Another time, he said, "The maid is not dead, but merely sleepeth." Most people in this lifetime spiritually are asleep. They're only in various stages of awakening. Whatever we will ever be, we already are. That was a great, great mystical truth that Jesus spoke about to those that could understand. He also alluded to the fact that I speak to them in parables, because having ears to hear, they hear not. Well, obviously they had physical ears, But obviously, whatever was entering the physical ears was not connecting with what was between the two ears. And it's the same situation today. We have people that can hear absolute truth and not have a vaguest idea what's being said. Just like an infant, you can tell them higher truth in terms of living in this physical life, but they don't understand. And we don't punish them for not understanding. We basically realize that sooner or later, they will understand to some degree the ways of the world. The same situation applies here. It applies in the idea of how much can we comprehend? When we come to anything that is secret, you can only understand it if you're ready to understand it. Now, another key element of understanding when we say the secret teachings of Christ, there was one key thing in the New Testament that's very much looked over by traditional Christianity. And that is when he said, I speak to them not in words of men, but in words of spirit. So whatever was coming forth from the mouth of Jesus, the personage, was really being spoken by the Christ within Jesus. Now, what am I saying here? Am I isolating Christ from Jesus, the personage, from the Spirit that is called Christ? Yes and no. When the full Spirit is working within every one of us, we are then, in that moment, the Christ. We are in that moment, actually, for all intents and purposes, the manifestation of God. However, that doesn't happen 24 hours a day, every moment of every day. Whenever we have any real humanity inside of us, whenever we have any real compassion inside of us, whenever we are selfless in our actions, whenever we are thinking only of others and not ourselves, then we find those great moments where this consciousness has come through us, where in those brief moments we are more than simply physical flesh and bone, where the flesh and bone in and of itself has become then a vehicle or a channel, as it were, for the bringing forth of higher truth, a higher reality. So let's take a look at the first affirmation, which says, I understand that there is an outer and an inner teaching of Christ, and it is up to the spiritual awareness of each soul to choose which. Now, most people will choose the outer because they are not awakened enough to have an appreciation of anything inner. You can't really teach algebra to somebody until they have learned the basics of math, or basic arithmetic, multiplication, division, addition, subtraction. You're getting ahead of yourself. I mean, you put different things in front of a person, algebra, trigonometry, whatever it might be, and you tell them, hey, figure this out. What does all this mean? Well, if they don't even know the basics or have an appreciation, there's no bridge between not knowing and knowing. And it is the same thing when it comes to religion and it comes to spirituality and it comes to whatever is being taught under the name of spirituality. And so there is an outer type of religion and there is an inner spiritual teaching. What is that inner spiritual teaching? Is it just Christian? No. The inner spiritual teaching is within all basic religions that have any real spiritual substance to them. The same basic teaching is within the Hindu teaching, it's within Buddhism, it's within many, many different cultures. However, there is a thing that distinguishes the lifetime of Jesus and of Christ from every other great teacher that has come on this earth. And that is that it was recognized that in the Western culture, those souls incarnating into Western culture were not that awakened to be able to understand higher, deeper spiritual truth. And so it became something that Jesus' life, every act in Jesus' life, had to symbolize something that is an internal process that deals with the secret teachings. Whether it started with the birth of Christ to symbolize the birth of Christ consciousness within ourselves, whether it was symbolized by the death on the cross and the resurrection, symbolizing the death of the human consciousness and the rebirth of divine consciousness within a person, symbolized by many, many different things, this is the way that it unfolds. So we have the inner and we have the outer. Why do we have both? Because as I said a moment ago, most of the souls incarnating into Western culture, and I don't mean to put Western culture down, but most of them are more materially inclined. Those that are incarnating more into bodies that are of the Hindu bent, of Buddhism, those souls have been exposed to more abstract thought in previous lives. They come in here more awakened, and thus they can be told the truth more in a frontal situation. That is why if you pick up the Bhagavad Gita as an example, the Hindu gospel, great profound truths are right laid bare before you. If those same truths were to be taught to Western culture, they would be clothed in symbolism and in parables until such time as a person could awaken spiritually enough to be able to interpret the inner or the true or the secret meaning of these things. So again, this is not a put down on Western culture. It just happens to be, if you want real truth, that most of the people that incarnate into Western culture are more materialistic in their consciousness. They are more wanting the physical type of situation. That is not to say that others in other civilizations don't want the physical as well, or put that in a prime area of importance in their lives. So when Jesus came, the idea was, here comes a very, very high soul, indeed a Messiah soul, to be able to bring spirituality to the Western culture and Western civilization. The recognition came before the incarnation that you can only teach these people up to a certain degree. And so there's only a few people here that will be able to understand you. Those people will become the disciples. That's how few there were available. Because as we all know, there were only 12 disciples. So here you have all of these mobs of people following Jesus around, but only a dozen that could really understand or interpret. And so there became then the necessity to have two different teachings, one for the outer person, the person that simply could not understand the abstract, the subtleties. And if they even began to comprehend them, they would ridicule them. Hence the words, cast not thy pearl before the swine. Because it's just an idea that a person lives in a state of pig consciousness, as it were. The life is no more than a pig wallowing around in the coolness of the mud engulfing their bodies. And humanity, by and large, in terms of spiritual comprehension, is just about at that level. Give any type of panic situation, any type of war, any type of situation where you have chaos, and you have two different things that can happen. One is it can bring out the best in you, or it can bring out the worst in you. both elements are present. It can bring out the primordial swampland of unawakened soul life, or it can bring out the greatest celestial type of consciousness possible. However, on a day-to-day basis, the average person in our Western culture doesn't want to comprehend. They are here for material purposes. The material life is what attracts a soul to this planet, to this lifetime. Yet, with every grouping of souls, there's always a few that are in advance. Those are the people that are supposed to make available the inner or the secret teaching to those few that are ready for it. Let's suppose, as an example, just for the sake of conversation, we have 100 souls that incarnate into our Western culture. Out of that 100 souls, maybe we might have one that might qualify to teach the others the deeper spiritual secrets of life. Then we have maybe 99 left. Now, how many of those 99 can really comprehend? First of all, I doubt if you only had 100 people to work with that you'd find a real teacher. Secondly, if you had 100 people, only 100 people to work with, I doubt you would find one student, one person that was ready to comprehend. Think about this. You can lay truth out, but unless a person is ready for it, it doesn't connect in their mind. It doesn't connect in their consciousness. I've learned this over the years. I've learned it when trying to bring truth to people. Whenever, as an example, we put in some type of large advertisement in a newspaper or a magazine, unless that particular newspaper is very, very specific to a specific audience, or the magazine is to a specific audience, it doesn't make a bit of difference. The people will look at it, they will not understand it, they will not comprehend it, they cannot identify with it, and nor can they associate with it. Hence, it doesn't exist. Having eyes to see, they see not. In other words, if I took and ran a full-page ad in the average newspaper in this country today, or in any country for that matter, and brought out the absolute truth, people would look at it, they would absolutely not register. They would not say, oh my, how profound. Oh, is that interesting. Oh my gosh, that explains everything. It would just bounce off of them. And that's the way it is. So we have the outer and we have the inner. Now, those of you that are here with me today, most of you I've seen more than one time, so I recognize that here's a possibility. There's an expression in India that I've sometimes quoted, which says, oh, for the thousands of teachers, find me one true student. Oh, for the thousands of teachers, find me one true student. There has to be an appreciation. There has to be a feeling that truth tickles your fancy more than anything else. Let me repeat that. That truth tickles your fancy more than anything else. That is the biggest turn on. Now, for most people, if they have a book on sex and they have a book on truth, which one tends to tickle their fancy? Well, we know. But for the true student will say, all right, you know, enough of this. We know enough about this particular subject. But to know the mysteries of life, to be able to comprehend why I'm here, to be able to comprehend where I might be if I wasn't here, they be able to comprehend, was I somewhere before I was here? Is there a possibility that I'll be somewhere the moment I stop breathing? And what? How about in between? How about in between birth and death? What am I? What is the whole of this life? Why am I even here? Why is there happiness and why is there pain? All of the great philosophical questions that need to be answered. A wise philosopher once said, the unexamined life isn't worth living. The unexamined life isn't worth living. Now, I don't know how many of you agree with that or not, but I certainly identify totally and completely with that statement. Because without an examination of what everything is and who we are, we flounder. So when it says that there was an inner and an outer, what that means is that there was an outer type of religion based upon the life of Jesus that was formed, and then an inner teaching that was just given to the disciples that only they who had reached a certain period of spiritual awakening could comprehend. And even with the disciples, at times, it was difficult. Because again, you're dealing with two different worlds. You're dealing with this physical world that your soul is in, inhabiting a body. And then you're dealing with a world of subtlety and spirit. So first it says the outer. It says, I understand that the outer teaching of Christ focuses more on human identification or the personage of Jesus and is thus more readily acceptable by the greater masses of people. People can identify with other people. They like to have a physical form. And so you take all of these different things that have happened in the life of Jesus and you use them as symbols that when a person becomes awakened sufficiently, all of those symbols of divine birth and resurrection, they all take on totally, totally different and highly more personalized meanings because they become then a part of your life, a part of my life, a part of anybody's life that is awakened enough to be able to understand and to comprehend what is taking place. Then it says inner. It says, I understand that the inner teaching of Christ centers on the Christ mind. It doesn't center on the personality of a person called Jesus. It centers on the Christ mind. Whether that Christ mind was in Jesus or whether it's in you or whether it was in Buddha or whether it was in Krishna or whether it was in Plato or Socrates or whoever else that we might look up to as being a person of wisdom, whether it was in there 1 minute a day or 24 hours a day, it doesn't matter. That is what we concentrate on. Now you say, well, how can we isolate? We isolate because there is what we call Christ consciousness. And we have to define what that is. It says the Christ part of consciousness and cannot be comprehended until awareness in a soul has reawakened to a greater state of oneness between itself and the creating spirit or God. Between the creating spirit or God. You know, so many people are looking for answers, but the goal is what can we get out of it in this physical life? And that's understandable. People have problems. They want love in their life. They want enough to be able to meet their material needs. They want healthy bodies. We understand that. And the awakened soul understands that. And part of what Jesus tried to get through as the Christ mind spoke through him was, your Father knoweth you have need of these things before you ask. It's very, very interesting as we go through this next few weeks how much in contrast what I call the psychology of the Christ mind is to the psychology of motivational speakers today. It seems like everybody is dealing with the human element of consciousness in teaching people how to improve their lives. Let me explain. In most motivational business type seminars, The thing that is told you is to concentrate, focus in on your goal, become one-pointed on your goal, single-minded on that goal, live it, breathe it, etc., etc. Can I see a show of hands of anybody that's encountered that in their studies? I mean, if you've read any kind of self-help books, I mean, that's basically the same mantra that is in all of them. Now, what did Jesus say? What did the Christ Spirit say through him? Give not thought what you shall eat. Give not thought about anything, because your needs will be supplied. Give not thought. Bees are the lilies of the field, they spin and they toil not, and yet they grow. So humankind, Western culture, the way that we're brought up, is to spin our intellectual cylinders, just like the old-fashioned slot machines in Las Vegas, where they have all of these clanky wheels going around and around and around. That's the human mind. Clanky wheels going around and around and around and around. So the secret teaching, as far as your needs are concerned, is totally contrary to what is being taught by motivational and business groups. Now you say, well, heck, it works, because if you just keep focusing in on what you want, I mean, that becomes your whole life. And that's it. I know many people who that has become their whole life. I know many people who have become very, very wealthy because that is their whole life. But what profiteth a man if he gaineth the world and loseth his soul? And he was taken up into a high mountain, and the devil, meaning the lower nature, the human nature, tempted him. Tempted him, I'll give you all of the kingdoms of the world, because you've reached that particular point of awareness inside of yourself, where in effect you know all of the weaknesses of human beings, and you know how to play upon them. You know how to take advantage of them. Have any of you ever gotten to a point in your relationship with one or more people where you recognize that there was a weakness in this other person, and that you could, if you wanted to, take advantage of their vulnerability? Can I see by a show of hands? Then you know exactly what I'm talking about. Let's suppose that you are so aware and so conscious that it wouldn't be just one person. It could be all of civilization. It could be all of the kingdoms of this world. That shows something. It shows that there is a contrary situation here between what people believe that they need and how to get it, and what they have to do to obtain it, i.e. sell their goodness down the toilet in order to be able to obtain the trinkets of this earth. It makes no sense. Because you can have it both ways. Now, when you have it both ways, it depends upon what your needs are. Because the promise is, according to the secret teaching, there's a part of you that is God, and God knows what you have need of, and God will supply it. Well, what do we need? We need a roof over our heads. We need food on the table. We need clothes on our backs. We need a healthy body, a healthy mind, and above all, a healthy soul. And beyond that, what do we really need? Well, you might say, well, we need transportation to get from one place to another. Well, that isn't such a big deal. What beyond that? Before you had cars, you had donkeys. You had horses. They were supplied. We didn't need any large manufacturers of transportation. But God has supplied through us, given us the insight in order to be able to manufacture things and so forth. But you see, when certain things take over, then greed takes over. And when the greed takes over, then we have chemistry comes to our supposed aid. The pharmaceutical companies come here to Earth to save us. I remember there was a song that was really popular when I was a kid. I can't remember all of the words, but it went something like, Grandpa so-and-so died at 93, doing what came naturally, doing what came naturally. Well, that's the way it is. I had grandparents that hardly ever went to a doctor. They lived into their late 80s. I had a great-grandmother that never went to a doctor. She lived to 102. I mean, how do you figure this? How do you figure it? You figure that it's part of the soul. That great-grandmother that I had that lived to be 102, I said this last week, last Sunday, that to me health begins in the soul. If the soul is healthy, the mind is healthy, and in turn the body is healthy. My great-grandmother, she was raised in Greece, and she didn't speak much of the American language, but enough to be able to get by, certainly more than a lot of people today. But there was one thing that she had that I never saw in another person, and that was that any time I would bring somebody over to visit, the first thing she would do, she wouldn't say hello or anything. She would run up and give them a real big hug, and I mean it was from the heart. A big hug from the heart. That was, to me, a spiritual act. It was a spirit, it was the God part of herself. And you couldn't help it on the very first meeting but to love this woman. Because the woman brought total love to you immediately the moment you stepped through the door, the moment before I could say anything. She had only one bad day in her life. That was the day that she passed. And she had a couple of other times where she, when television was introduced into her home, that she sometimes felt that she should be very clothed when before she passed in front of the television set because she felt that these men were looking at her, and but that's neither here nor there. The point is that we have a deeper, higher spiritual nature that goes beyond intellect, goes beyond language. There's one of you over here that I referred to as a love being a couple of Sundays ago or whenever it was, and you know, he has a favorite song. You don't need to know the language with a girl in your arms and a look in her eye and the moon in the sky. All right. It goes beyond. It simply goes beyond intellect. It goes beyond language. Does that make sense? It goes beyond language. We place so much emphasis upon language and communication and semantics and linguistics, etc., 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 but it goes beyond. When a person has a higher religious experience, a really profound experience, if they have contact with some type of higher being, in this vision between themselves and the higher beingness, there isn't verbal communication. Hey, hi there, Ralph. How are you doing? Just doing fine on this earth life. It isn't that kind of communication. There's nothing said. There doesn't have to be anything said. It's an exchange of energies. It's an exchange of knowingness. Life is different. That's part of what Jesus and the Christ within Jesus gave to the disciples that awakened higher states of consciousness within themselves, or reawakened. The Christ mind defined, it says, I understand Christ, the Christ mind is part of the consciousness of myself and everyone. That's important, everyone. Whether they are conscious of it or not, and is a part of the mind where individual identity is sublimated into Christ-like oneness with Spirit or God. A point within our minds where our personal selfhood dissolves and we are in a state of onement with the universe. Christ, the body of Christ, is an infinite field of light. God is infinite, unmanifest spirit. The body of God is infinite, unmanifest spirit. It is two sides of the same coin. One side is the unmanifest darkness, the other side is the manifest light. The dark inside, and I don't mean this in a negative way, I just mean it in an unmanifest way, is the God spirit. The first created, or the firstborn, the Christ, is the light. Side of God. You have to have the light in order to be able to distinguish objects and life forms in order to be and create what looks like individualized lives. So the Christ mind defined then, I understand the Christ mind again is part of myself and everyone, whether they're conscious of it or not. Most people are not conscious of it. And so when it says Christ mind consciousness, I understand that I may live my daily life under the influence. How many times have we heard that expression, under the influence? Hey, that person's under the influence. Generally, it's under Jim Beam or one of those other things. Has Jim Beam come to Earth? But isn't it possible that we could be under the influence of a higher state of spiritual intoxication or reality within ourselves? And when we're in touch with that Christ part of ourselves, we are in touch with that inner essence that is a part of us. And then we come under the influence of it, of the Christ part of my mind, which acts as a bridge. That's an important buzzword in this affirmation. Acts as a bridge or a contact point between my individual human existence and God. No man cometh to the Father except through me. No man cometh through the Father except through me. What does that mean? No man cometh through the Father through Jesus? No. No man cometh through the Father, the Christ within Jesus. Remember the words I said, I speak to them not in words of men, but in words of spirit. So when Jesus moved his lips, it was the Christ speaking through him. And so no man cometh to the Father except through light. No man cometh to the Father, to the highest truth, except through light. Light is a state of consciousness within the human mind. It has been alluded to by all of the major religions. It has been alluded to in all of these things in recent decades we read about NDEs, near-death experiences. It has been alluded to and alluded to and alluded to, and yet most people just think in the outer religious that it is more symbolical. If thine eye be single, thy body shall be filled with light. Is that symbolical? No, it's actually literal. So what we have is when the person is working from an outer type of situation, they cannot see and decipher the inner. So it says, I understand that I may live my daily life under the influence of the Christ part of my mind, which acts as a bridge or contact point between my individual human existence and God. Christ mind influence, I understand that through the Christ part of my mind, God guides and directs me in all major concerns of my human life, including health, love, income, peace, fulfillment, lasting happiness, and eternal life. So we're led. We're guided. All right? We have a roof over our heads. We have clothes on our back. We ride a horse, or we ride something that has 300 horses, whatever it might be. We still, just the modern version of the horse and drawn carriage, that's all it is. But we have, in other words, it's always provided for us. It's provided for man. Either man will make some kind of mechanical contraption that he is inspired to do, or man will ride what has already been provided. He will provide a horse or a donkey or something else. But love and income and peace and fulfillment and above all, lasting happiness. So many times I've asked people, what was it going to take to make you happy? And you know that there are people that I have met that if you give them everything on an earthly scale, all of these things that are down here, love, it'll never be enough. Have any of you ever met a person like this? Why am I seeing some heads shake? Yes. It's never enough love. Well, God's love is enough love if you are in contact. And to make somebody happy, have you ever asked somebody that you're close to, what in God's name is it going to take to make you happy? In other words, you're asking them, how about lasting happiness here? The only thing that will make us happy is that happiness that already exists inside of us in our oneness with the eternal. Because that brings joy, that brings laughter, that brings seeing the glass half full rather than half empty, seeing the optimistic side rather than to dwell on the negative side, seeing a side that is compassionate and understanding of the weaknesses of other people rather than to constantly be pointing a judgmental finger at this person and that person, this group or that group. It's like recently here in the news in the past few days, there was alluding to the ancient practice of being stoned to death. What was the difference between Jesus and other teachers? Which of you is without sin? Who will cast the first stone? That, my friend, is the difference between Jesus and the other, some of the other teachers, not all of them, but some of them. So meditation, I understand that through my daily practice of meditation, my consciousness opens to Christ mind awareness and thus God's influence, who knows exactly what I have need of before I ask. So when you get into the secret areas of this teaching, you begin to see that this is in contrast to the motivational business type seminars that people are attending that drive the person to accomplishment, goal setting, etc., etc. And what I'm saying here is that all of this is upside down. It's backward. Because part of the secret teaching was to seek first the kingdom of heaven, not as an after-death place because you belong to a certain religion, but as a higher state of consciousness of God presence within ourselves. And then everything that we need, a roof over our head, clothes on our back, a means of transportation, food on the table, everything that our basic human needs will be met. And can we find then lasting happiness with those basic human needs met? If you were to wake up every morning and you would say to yourself, I don't have to strain and push and intellectualize and try to figure out how I'm going to keep a roof over my head, how I'm going to do this, how I'm going to do that. And each day you woke up with gratitude to say thank you for being aware to the God presence within yourself of my needs and supplying them. I understand that through my daily practice of meditation, my consciousness opens to Christ mind awareness and thus God's influence, who knows exactly what I have need of before I ask. Then a person has to make a decision. A person can come into any type of secret or higher teachings of Christ or any other culture. And then they have to make the decision, does this tickle my fancy? Am I turned on enough in the pursuit of truth, whatever that truth turns out to be? Come hell or high water, that I put that number one, not the pursuit of my own personal fame or glory, not the pursuit of anything that deals with the financial. If I pursue truth, truth will take care of me, because truth is God. Truth is the ultimate. Truth is the absolute. You get in touch with the absolute inside of yourself, your mind is awakened. You don't need to take notes, you don't need to work from notes. It's as simple as that. Because the highest truth is the simplest truth. It is uncomplicated. People that are the most neurotic are the most complicated. Because the whole of their life revolves around me. And so they create a maze, and then they try to find themselves out of a mental maze that they've created. Simplify, as Thoreau said. Simplify. Uncomplicate your life. And so it says, I understand that the choice is mine to either stay with the outer teaching, which is fine. Hey, if that's all that's your thing for this lifetime, fine. Hallelujah, brother and sister. Jesus saves. Okay? All right? If you'd like to go further, then you have to fill in the blank. Or you just fill in the blank. I'm going to stay with the outer. The outer makes sense to me. That's fine. Awakened souls understand that's fine. You've got to go with X religion. Even though ex-religion is telling you ours is the only way and everybody else is going to go to hell. As stupid as that is, and it is, still, if that's your bag, be my guest. I won't judge you for it. I won't judge the idiots that are on their idiot lifetime that teach it. I mean, Christ referred to this when he said, and the blind shall lead the blind, and both shall fall into the ditch. In other words, you're not really going to get anywhere. You'll follow it. You'll shout your hallelujahs on Sunday morning, and then you'll shout hell the rest of the week. You'll go in as self-righteous on Sunday mornings, and the rest of the week, you're a curse to everybody who sees you. Yeah. Be ye not as the hypocrites, seen in the synagogues, praying before men, So we'll get more into that, into the real secret teaching next week. But I wanted to give you an idea here that this duality that exists within Christianity, the spoken of Christianity and the unspoken Christianity. The outer Christianity spoken of to the masses, the inner Christianity, the unspoken. And so we're going to take it apart bit by bit, and many of you that have been through this series before will take new slants on it to give it a freshness for you. All right, I'm going to ask that you sit back in your chairs, put both feet flat on the floor, your ankles crossed, whichever is most comfortable for you, and we'll take a few moments to enter into a state of meditation. Let your eyes close if you would, sit back, spine straight in your chairs, and let's think along together. I turn away from the outer world for a few moments to enter into the innermost world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. To turn my outer senses in upon myself. To reverse my mind in upon itself. To turn away from the outer world that surrounds me, that I may enter into the inner world that is within me. A world within, yet a world that goes far beyond the physical confines of my body. For within myself there is a light that is constantly shining, whether I am awake or whether I am asleep, a light that was before my body was, is during this lifetime, and will continue long after this life is no more. And so I move in consciousness, opening myself to that light within. The energies that I normally use for outer sense perception are now turned inward for inner sense perception. And I move in consciousness, moment by moment, and breath by breath, to the center of beingness within myself, where all is at peace, all is calm, all is tranquil. I see myself surrounded in an aura of pure white light emanating forth from the upper torso of my body. And it is to the center of that light, the nucleus of consciousness within myself, that I direct my mental footsteps. The entirety of my body melting away in consciousness to that light that is within me. And a peace now settling throughout the entirety of my being. The light around me engulfing me in peace, while the peace that is within me, generating that light, exists at all levels of my mind, both known and unknown. Throughout my beingness now, I exist in light consciousness, in awareness, in beauty, in a state of Christ-mind oneness with the eternal that is within me. I rest in silence for a few moments, feeling a Christ mind presence within myself, feeling my feet, my ankles, my calves, my knees, my thighs, the lower torso of my body, my lower back, my upper back, my abdominal wall, my chest area, my shoulders, down each arm into my hands, through my neck, through my face, throughout my skull area, throughout the entirety of my body from the crown of my head, down the length of my body to the soles of my feet, a greater presence, a greater reality. The presence of Christ mind, Christ consciousness, oneness with God. And in the very center of my body, the letters spelling out, I am. I identify with those letters. I am. I merge with those letters in consciousness. I am. I acknowledge and declare within myself that I am under the influence of that I am. And though in a few moments my eyes and senses will open once again to the world around me, I will retain and be under the influence of the I am Christ mind consciousness, my bridge to the eternal infinite spirit that is God. And so now, ever so slowly, I'll begin to return my senses to the outside world. And as I do, ever so slowly, I'll begin to open my eyes and senses once again to the exterior world. But I will retain the influence of the inner, the I am, the Christ, consciousness, mind, guiding me. So my eyes open slowly and I raise my arms and my hands high over my head. And I do this as a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher in my life, knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars and of the heavens, having taken individualized shape, form, and embodiment. I bring down my hands, resting in the security, the peace, the knowingness that this is so throughout me, and so it is.